Dear colleagues, Namaskar and a very warm welcome to the second webinar on COVID-19 organized by AIIMS New Delhi at its SET facility. Today we will talk on COVID-19 management and we'll have a couple of talks on this topic followed by a question and answer session. So I would request you to kindly send in your questions through live chat and we will try to answer as many of them as possible at the end of the talks. I would also like to inform you that this YouTube will be available on the same link so that the colleagues who have not been able to join live may be able to see the webinar at a later time. The first talk will be by Professor Anant Mohan, who is the head of pulmonary medicine at AIIMS New Delhi. So may I ask for the first talk, please?
Good morning and welcome to this webinar series in which today we shall be discussing regarding the management of coronavirus, the COVID-19 that we are into these days. I'll take you through the management of stable COVID-19, not focusing on the acute management as of now in this part, that will be covered separately. So as you all know, COVID-19 is a very important emerging viral respiratory illness which is caused by the SARS coronavirus 2, initially identified in Wuhan, the city of China. And now it is actually, this data is slightly old, but as of now it has affected more than 187 countries, more than 6 lakh cases, more than 7 lakh cases actually, and more than 35 to 40,000 deaths have occurred. As we all know, the disease is transmitted through respiratory droplets and the clinical presentation may vary from spectrum may vary from just stable, mild, self-limiting type illness to a stable, to a more of a severe or life-threatening illness causing ARDS and sepsis, septic shock as just a little bit about the clinical symptomatology. The onset occurs within mostly within 10 days of the exposure. And it is mostly manifested by the presence of fever, presence of dry cough, mostly dry cough, maybe sometimes associated with expectoration, and also shortness of breath. And in a small percentage of cases, it may need hospitalization. So this spectrum is what is known as the SARI, which is the severe acute respiratory illness about which we will be talking. The COVID-19 SARI surveillance case definitions include the following. So for surveillance purposes, a SARI occurring in a person who has got a history of fever and also cough and he requires admission to the hospital but doesn't have any other etiology that fully explains the clinical presentation, and along with that he should have any of the following, that is a history of international travel in the past 14 days previously to the symptom onset, and also the disease which occurs in a healthcare worker who has been working in an environment where patients are there with SARI and you know we don't know about their place of residence or history of travel, or somebody who develops an unexplained or unusual clinical course especially related to his respiratory symptoms, respiratory failure, and one doesn't really know his history of travel or place of residence, and there is no substantial cause kind of identified as for the illness. Secondly, a person with any degree of respiratory illness or severity who within the last 14 days had any of these following exposure, that is a close physical contact with a confirmed case of COVID while that patient was symptomatic, and also a person who is working in a healthcare facility in a country where significant number of COVID-19 infections have been reported. Continuing with that, the severity of illness also ranges from mild uncomplicated illness to severe complicated illnesses, and we won't go through all these definitions in detail, but mild illness, just like any other flu-like upper respiratory illness, non-specific symptoms, fever, dry cough, sore throat, a bit of nasal congestion, malaise and headache. And atypical symptoms may occur in the elderly or those who are immunosuppressed. Then there may be the symptom of pneumonia, the spectrum of pneumonia which may be mild, severe or complicated, which may or may not be associated with any signs of severe pneumonia, or severe pneumonia, this is the important group in which the subjects have got tachypnea, they may have hypoxemia or they may have severe respiratory signs of severe respiratory distress as manifested by the use of accessory muscles, not able to speak in complete sentences, and so on. And then there is another spectrum of the very severe complicated illness, which manifest as ARDS type picture, may have sepsis, septic shock, altered sensorium and other neurological features. So this spectrum is a kind of range of spectrum of the clinical. As far as management is concerned, I think management starts first with triaging. So when the person comes to the hospital with a particular symptom, then triaging is extremely important to identify the severity of the illness and also to initiate appropriate infection prevention and control practices. So initially, all patients with respiratory symptoms of fever, cough and shortness of breath must be screened prior to entry to the healthcare facility. If possible, a phone number may be provided to the patients to inform the healthcare facility prior to the visit if it is feasible. Ideally, one should designate a waiting area for the respiratory patients which should be more than 6 feet away from the general waiting areas. All patients with respiratory symptoms should be given a face mask to wear. And as far as the hospital practices are concerned, in areas where community transmission is already occurring, one should consider postponing elective procedures and non-essential visits to the healthcare facility, as already has been done in several health facilities. So here we can see the triage flow. So a general algorithm, any patient coming with fever, cough or shortness of breath, we kind of analyze any of the following: a history of international travel in the last 2 weeks, a history of contact with any known confirmed COVID-19 patient, a healthcare worker or anybody having unexplained severe acute respiratory illness requiring hospitalization. If none of these is there, then a person goes for the usual care for his symptoms and does not need any hospitalization or probably any further workup. Whatever workup has to be done at the discretion of the treating clinician. But if he does have any of these following features, then basically we have to sub-classify whether he is a mild case or he is a moderate to severe case. Then these are the following features that have to be taken into account and quickly screened for: presence of tachypnea, hypoxemia as manifested by decrease in SpO2, altered mental status with confusion and drowsiness, hypotension with systolic less than 90, diastolic less than 60, or any of the high risk factors for developing or severe disease. So these high risk factors are as written below: elderly age group more than 60, presence of cardiovascular disease which includes hypertension, presence of diabetes mellitus, any other immunocompromised state, for example cancer or taking immunosuppressive medications, or patients having pre-existing chronic lung, kidney or liver disease. All of these fall into the category of high risk patients who may go on to develop severe illness. So if any of these is present, then he is classified into a moderate or a severe case. If none of these are present, then he is a mild case. At that point of time, the testing has to be done. The testing means the nasopharyngeal and the oropharyngeal aspirates have to be tested, and the patient has to be considered for isolation if it is test positive. So we can even consider home isolation in this group of patients if we are sure of the compliance, and or if we are overburdened in the hospital, home isolation is also possible, but he has to be very, very closely monitored. And if he is test negative, then he follows the usual care as for any other patient. If any of these factors is present, he goes into the moderate to severe category. And over here, he has to be tested and then he has to be admitted. And then in admission, he has to be monitored, and monitoring has to be done so as to look at the cardiovascular status, look at the respiratory status, and also for the worsening mentation. So any of the hospital admissions will be indicated in any one of these following being present, which we have already talked about: the tachypnea, hypoxemia, altered mental status, hypotension, and presence of any of the risk factors that we have already talked about. We should remember that there is a large list of differential diagnoses of these patients. Influenza is of course a very, very common cause of upper respiratory symptoms, and influenza virus is also transmitting in the community. And seasonal influenza, swine flu, H3N2, they are both preventable and treatable, or sometimes avian flu, what used to be there a couple of years back. We should not forget the bacterial and the atypical pneumonias which may present with SARI. We should also not forget various tropical fevers which may present with ARDS, including dengue, leptospirosis, malaria, and some other diseases such as rickettsia. So all of these should fall under the differential diagnosis when we are treating with or dealing with a patient with respiratory in this particular scenario. Then sample has to be collected, and again in very brief, one has to collect nasopharyngeal swabs and one has to collect the throat swabs or the oropharyngeal swabs. And these are not the normal cotton swabs or the wood shafts that normally has to be taken. Ideally, one has to use sterile Dacron and rayon swabs, and then there is a particular way of taking that. So we won't go into those details right now, but those swabs have to be collected and shifted in a particular transport medium for testing. This is the upper respiratory tract samples, but lower respiratory tract samples may also be collected in those who have got radiographic evidence or a clinical diagnosis of LRTI in certain situations, because they may have some impact on clinical interventions. This include expectorate sputum. Usually this is not encouraged because of a risk of transmission of the disease while coughing or expectorating out the sputum, so this is not really encouraged. Tracheal aspirates and bronchoalveolar lavage can be done in those patients who are on a ventilator, who are intubated. So if required, these procedures can be performed. But because they can generate aerosols, very strict and very careful airborne precautions have to be used during these. If intubated patients are there, we can collect tracheal aspirates, and using a sterile collection trap, we should not send the suction catheter tip to the laboratory in this kind of a situation. There are just some certain useful practice points that take into account. Prognostication of these patients is also important. All persons who have got bacterial and fungal co-infections, they have poor prognosis. Older age, obesity, and other comorbidities also have a poor prognosis. So one group tried to take out a predictive score for mortality, and this score more than 12 was a higher predictor of mortality. This included multilobar infiltration in the chest, lymphopenia, bacterial co-infection, a presence of a smoking history, presence of hypertension, and age more than 60 years. So giving various points to all of these, a total score of more than 12 was predictive of a more higher mortality in this particular. So coming to the management per se, management of a mild illness usually does not require any hospital interventions, but isolation would be definitely required to contain the virus transmission. If there is a small number of cases and facilities are available, it is advisable to isolate in hospital itself, because there would be better monitoring, there can be better supervision over there. Or if one can use the repurposed non-traditional settings, for example, if there is a huge big pandemic, large cluster of cases, then one can use stadiums, auditoriums, and hotels also. This has been done in certain situations. Or if not possible in hospital, then home isolation is also a good option. And one has to be just very carefully monitoring these patients to make sure that they are following the precautions, infection control precautions, which are required at that time to protect the family members and also the community. So very good counseling about the signs and symptoms of complicated disease also have to be told, so that the patient report back as soon as they have any other abnormal type of a symptoms that may require. These are just some of the publications which came out the last couple of weeks regarding the patients who were infected in China, and they described the clinical features as also the management. They were in JAMA and the NEG. The management of mild disease mostly is just like any other upper respiratory illness or mild lower respiratory illness, with antibiotics like paracetamols, good hydration. Antibiotics, for example, azithromycin or amoxiclavulinic acid may be given if clinically indicated. If influenza is being strongly suspected or it has been diagnosed, then oseltamivir should be given, and the role of hydroxychloroquine will be taken up in subsequent. There have been several myths and several rumors which have also been doing the rounds regarding the adverse effects of certain drugs which can be found to be harmful in this particular disease. So ibuprofen was one of them, and it was thought whether ibuprofen can worsen disease for patients with COVID-19. At present, the WHO says that there is no current available evidence to and fro that, so it does not recommend against the use of ibuprofen. And that is some of the myths that are being dispelled as of now, citing lack of current evidence for this. Then other therapies, for example, patients may have comorbidity, they may be taking antihypertensive. So those who are taking ACE inhibitors or ARBs, as of now, they can continue the same pending further evidence. There is no guideline recommending that they should not be given or they should be stopped. Also, a large number of patients may be receiving immunomodulatory agents. Immunocompromised patients are at increased risk for severe disease. So they may be on steroids, they may be on other biological agents. So that is for their other the disease, pre-existing disease that they have. In this situation, the decision whether to continue the treatment already going on or not to continue, because in this setting of infection, that again a blanket statement has not been given, and that decision has to be taken on a case-to-case basis. More often than not, it is advised to continue the standard therapy unless it is absolutely essential. Hence, the general recommendations for home management. So if most of the patients are fit to be kept at home, then certain guidelines have to be followed, and these are ideally the person should stay in a single room with an individual washroom. The patient movement in the house should be limited. Household members ideally should stay in separate rooms or at least stay more than 1 meter away. One should try and limit the number of caregivers. Preferably only one healthy person should be there with the looking after the patient. Ideally, he should not be having any risk factors himself, otherwise he will himself be in a high risk category. Very good hand hygiene has to be followed, especially after any type of contact. Caregiver should always wear a medical mask whenever in the same room as the patient, and also by the patient when they are handling any kind of secretions, they wear the medical mask, and that should be disposed of properly as well. So there are separate guidelines for disposal of medical mask, and that guidelines should be, again to reiterate some of them, one should avoid direct contact with respiratory secretions and body fluids. Laundry should be washed with a regular soap and water or with a machine wash at 60 to 90 degrees temperature. Infectious waste should be disposed of as per the local sanitary authority guidelines. Whatever is prevalent or existing at that place where he is residing, there should be no reuse of gloves or masks. All frequently touched surfaces should be disinfected and cleaned regularly and frequently with 0.1% sodium hypochlorite solution. So this is commonly can be made at home, and this can be done very common or very this should be done frequently to prevent any surface to body contamination. Ideally, there should be a dedicated linen and utensil for the patient, and one should use gloves and plastic apron for handling laundry and cleaning for the surfaces. So these are some of the practice guidelines or the practices which must be followed for a person who is being managed at home. Also, they should be given a clear-cut message, and they should be told what are the risk factors, what are the symptoms which can worsen. They should be instructed to return to the hospital if they develop worsening of any illness or any new symptoms come. What is the time for which home isolation should continue? It is ideally till one gets two negative PCR tests more than 24 hours apart, or till 2 weeks after the symptoms have resolved if repeat testing is by chance unavailable. So based on these two guidelines, one can then continue the home isolation, and after that one can label the person as cured. The other important group which needs defining and care is the contacts, the close contacts. The definition of close contacts is any person who lives in the same household as a COVID positive patient, or a healthcare worker who has had a direct physical contact with the COVID-19 case or his her infective secretions when he was not wearing recommended personal protective equipment, or with a possible breach of the PPE, or any person who was living in the same closed environment or who was in a closed environment or had a face-to-face contact with a COVID case within a distance of 1 meter, especially or including air travel. So these are the definitions of a close contact of COVID-positive patient. Management of these close contacts broadly depend upon or broadly are based upon quarantine measures, early case detection and chemoprophylaxis. So we'll quickly go one by one. As far as quarantining of close contacts is concerned, they should stay in a well-ventilated single room with an attached separate toilet. And again, the same distance measures, the same social distancing measures apply. Keep 1 meter distance away from other members. Stay away from high-risk groups like elderly, the pregnant ladies, children, and persons with comorbidities. Movement in the house should be restricted, and under no circumstances they should try and go to any kind of crowded places or attend any other social or religious gatherings. Again, hand hygiene measures are extremely important and they cannot be overemphasized, especially for these quarantined close contacts. Wash hands as often as possible thoroughly with soap and water or with an alcohol-based sanitizer. Surgical masks should be worn and they should be changed every 6 to 8 hours and they should be disposed of. One should try and avoid sharing household items, for example, the glasses, the dishes, utensils, linen and bedding and other items. And the masks should be either disinfected using ordinary bleach solution or the sodium hypochlorite solution 1% prior to any reuse. So these are some measures can be taken for quarantine measures. For early detection of these close contacts, one has to quickly pick up the symptoms. If symptoms appear, any of the symptoms, they should immediately inform the nearest health center by phone. The asymptomatic, direct and the high-risk contacts of confirmed cases ideally should be tested once anytime between 5 to 14 days after coming in contact with the positive patients. So at this point of time, testing should be done, and these guidelines are by the ICMR, and we have to keep in kind of touch because guidelines keep on changing. So this is what has to be done. An important question comes regarding the role of hydroxychloroquine in this particular situation. And hydroxychloroquine has been tested in vitro and in vivo trials, and they have found faster viral elimination in the patients with COVID-19 infection. However, in clinical trials, there is no evidence for the clinical use by using hydroxychloroquine as a prophylactic measure so far. ICMR has very recently recommended the use of hydroxychloroquine in the following settings only, and they have emphasized only in these settings and not as a blanket for all. So healthcare workers who are directly involved in providing care to suspect or confirmed COVID-19 patient, they are eligible for hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis, and asymptomatic close contacts, household contacts of confirmed COVID patients, they are also recommended to take hydroxychloroquine as prophylaxis. And the dose in the first case would be 400 milligram tablet BD for first day, and then 400 milligrams once a week for the next 7 weeks. Whereas in the latter situation, it is 400 mg BD for first day and 400 mg once a week for the next 3 weeks. So again, remember, these are the only two situations as of now where hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis is recommended. It is not recommended anything beyond that. It is not recommended for all healthcare workers across the board who may not even be coming in contact or who are not engaged in taking care of suspected respiratory or COVID positive patients. So this is an important message that one would like to give to everybody, because already this has led to shortage of hydroxychloroquine. So this kind of a panic situation should arise. So that was about the management of stable patients. Now for the hospitalized patients, again, some general measures have to be followed. General investigations may be done, that is the CBCs, LFTs, ABG, blood culture and a chest x-ray as a baseline, and other investigations can be done as per clinically indicated. That may include investigations for heart failure and other comorbidities. Close monitoring of the vitals have to be done, that is needless to say. Supplemental oxygen therapy, whenever a person is hypoxemic or in respiratory distress, it is the first thing to be initiated at around 5 liters per minute, which may be increased using a face mask with a reservoir back to maintain the SpO2 more than 94%. That should be the target SpO2 as of now. One should adopt a conservative fluid strategy because we know that very aggressive fluid strategy, very aggressive intravenous fluid administration may prevent worsen oxygenation and may actually need to more need of mechanical ventilation. So in a potential situation of ARDS, we really don't need to give a very very stringent high fluid kind of a antibiotics. Empirical antibiotics may be given according to the setting. For example, depending upon the hospital setting where the person may be working, if there is any evidence or a suspicion of CAP or a HAP, then empirical antibiotics may be given. Oseltamivir may be given if there is a significant circulation of influenza virus in the community of that particular area. And of course, all the patient's comorbidities have to be managed and treated accordingly, whatever is there. As of now, there is no routine use of steroid therapy unless it is indicated for any of the comorbid conditions. So steroids per se for COVID-19 is not currently. In severe complicated COVID-19 infection, we have to recognize hypoxemic respiratory failure early. Apart from the bag, the face mask and reservoir oxygen, one may consider high flow nasal cannula or non-invasive ventilation also in highly selected patients, but with very, very close monitoring for clinical deterioration. NIV usually is not really recommended because it is an aerosol generating procedure, so one really does not want to place the health workers and the surrounding environment also at risk. So if at all it is required, and if one wants to kind of give a trial to prevent intubation, one may do with very, very strict infection prevention and control systems. But we should remember that NIV should not lead to a delay of intubation if the person develops ARDS. So one should not actually cause increased mortality because of that. Hence, if intubation is required, it has to be done with utmost aerosol precautions by a trained care provider. Mechanical ventilation should be performed and the setting should be as per the ARDS protocol. That will be dealt with in a separate webinar, the acute management of the patients with respiratory failure. Septic shock must be recognized and treated early with aggressive hemodynamic monitoring, and one has to prevent all the other complications and give the supportive care as one does for any critical illness patients, including DVT prophylaxis, stress ulcer prophylaxis and early mobilization. A couple of special situations which one would like to consider. For example, if COVID-19 infection occurs in a pregnant lady, then as of now there is no evidence that the disease pans out in a different manner in pregnancy as compared to others. So there is no evidence that pregnant women may present with different signs or symptoms, or if they are at a greater risk for severe illness. There is also currently no clear-cut evidence on mother-to-child transmission when the infection manifests in the third trimester, because various samples have been tested from the amniotic fluid, from the cord blood, from the vaginal discharge, neonatal throat swabs, and the breast milk, and so far whatever information is that they have all been tested negative. The mode of birth should be individualized based on the obstetric indications, and all routine care should be given as routine has to be given to these. Later, caring for the infants and mothers, the infection prevention control, and during the breastfeeding, the infants who are born to mothers who have suspected or confirmed COVID infection should be fed according to the standard feeding guidelines with necessary precautions for prevention of the infection from mother to child. Respiratory hygiene during feeding should be adopted. Use of a medical mask should be adopted. A good hand hygiene, needless to say, should be also adopted before and after contact with the child. And precautions should be taken to clean and disinfect the surfaces in which the symptomatic mother has come in contact. There are several pharmacological therapies which are also under investigation. As of now, there is no approved specific antiviral drug for COVID-19 till date. However, several therapies are under investigation and trial. These include hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine, which we will discuss subsequently. Then there are antivirals like lopinavir, ritonavir, which have been tried in successfully in HIV, and they are now being tried in COVID as well. Other antivirals, nucleotide analogs such as remdesivir, we'll see that in subsequent slides. Vitamin C is also undergoing clinical trials as an antioxidant and also as an anti-inflammatory agent. Then there are certain other antibodies, anti-inflammatory, anti-interleukin antagonists. For example, the tocilizumabs have been tried and they are also undergoing clinical trials, thinking of the possibility of a cytokine surge and a certain acute inflammatory response. And others like interferon beta are also being under consideration. A word about hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine. Both drugs have in vitro activity against SARS coronavirus. Hydroxychloroquine has a relatively higher potency. A recent French study used hydroxychloroquine for 10 days and showed significant reduction in the viral carriage at day 6 of treatment, although the improvement in clinical outcomes was still not very well studied. The addition of azithromycin, they showed increased efficiency of viral elimination, but there are certain adverse events that has to be taken into account, such as cardiac complications, cardiomyopathy, QT prolongation. Long-term use may lead to retinopathy, and there are some effects on the hepatotoxicity, the liver and the bone marrow. Lopinavir, ritonavir combinations also have shown in vitro activity against earlier viruses during the MERS epidemic and the SARS epidemic in a suggested dose of 200 by 50 mg twice daily for 14 days. In an open label trial in China, in about 199 patients with severe COVID infection, they did not find any significant improvement by using this drug. So basically, there was no difference in clinical improvement, there was no difference in 28-day mortality as well. So as of now, it is really recommended. Then another drug, which is the remdesivir, which is the nucleotide analog, inhibits viral replication through premature termination of RNA transcription. So it has some activity against SARS coronavirus 2 and related coronaviruses. Again, the dosing which is used in the ongoing clinical trials are in intravenous use, but right now, again, only in the context of clinical trials, it has been kind of suggested. It is not in any routine clinical as of now. Vitamin C as an antioxidant, again, the concept is in sepsis, there is a sudden cytokine surge, and it is postulated that vitamin C may help to eliminate the alveolar fluid and kind of reduce the inflammatory damage, and also reduce the vascular injury caused by this inflammatory damage. So, and also the concept that vitamin D deficiency may be related to increased risk and severity of the inflammatory infection. So with this concept, vitamin C may be tried, and it has been kind of recommended in the high risk situations. Talking about the IL-6, we have already just discussed about that. IL-6 inhibitor or antagonist can be tried to reduce the inflammatory response or the cytokine storm. And the tocilizumab is an IL-6 antagonist or inhibitor, which reduces the cytokines and other acute phase reactants. And it has been seen that the cytokine profile, which resembles HLH in associated with COVID-19, that enhances the disease severity and leads to higher mortality. And it is the cytokine storm in this situation is characterized by a rapid influx of several acute phase reactants, including the interleukins, the GM-CSF, the tumor necrosis factor alpha as well. So probably this agent might target them and might lead to clinical benefit. Again, this is under investigation. And this was one study which looked at this particular agent in China, where they found that the predictors of fatality were elevated ferritin, and that thereby they thought that maybe ferritin and inflammation is one of the factors associated with a higher mortality. So the treatment guidelines kind of recommend this particular agent for severe COVID-19 and those having elevated IL-6 levels. And there are certain drug reactions, and that we need to know. The bone marrow suppression, hepatotoxicity, and immunosuppression are known side effects, and that has been kept in mind. Lastly, WHO has started off a multicentric international RCT called the Solidarity Trial, which they are testing on confirmed COVID-19 patients, and then they are randomizing them to several different treatment groups: the chloroquine, the remdesivir group, or antiviral combinations and antivirals along with interferon beta versus standard therapy. So this has been launched, and probably we'll have to see in the next couple of weeks or month how the results come out to be, and maybe we'll have some more information related to this one. And apart from that, other things have also been tried: interferon beta, then injection of convalescent serum has been tried. This is from patients who recovered, and then their convalescent serum was then tried on to other active patients in order to try and develop immunity and reduce the viral load and the viral burden in this. Ribavirin also, but as of now, these are not standard therapies. A vaccine, numerous vaccine candidates are under evaluation, but as of now, none of them has actually got any kind of approval for use per se for use, because they are all under investigation in various Finally, the discharge criteria: once a person is asymptomatic in severe disease, one should note a single negative upper respiratory tract sample is not sufficient to exclude COVID, and one should ideally, if possible, do a lower respiratory tract sample. If not, another one should be repeated. In hospitalized samples with confirmed COVID-19, upper respiratory and lower respiratory tract samples can be collected to demonstrate viral clearance, and this should be done every 2 to 4 days. So the question may be how frequently one has to do the repeat sampling. So it can be done every 2 to 4 days until one demonstrates the virus clearing at least on the 2 samples. The frequency of specimen clearing will depend upon the local epidemic characteristics and the resources. And if a patient is clinically recovered and 2 negative tests which are performed at least at 24 hours apart, if they are negative, then we consider person fit to be discharged from the hospital. So the management protocol algorithm which was proposed at our institute is portrayed here, and this may kind of, it gives a broad overview of how management has to be done. Of any COVID-19 suspect, anybody having these criteria of SARI, acute respiratory illness, history of travel, close contact with a confirmed case, or a healthcare personnel who's managing respiratory illnesses, any of them, if they have any of the close contacts, or if they are asymptomatic travelers, when they develop symptoms, we classify them as a mild case or a moderate to severe case. If they are mild and if they have low grade symptoms, if they are H1N1 positive, then they can be given the treatment for that, as the antibiotics may be given on a case to case basis. Otherwise, broadly, more often than not, they are only given symptomatic management with paracetamol. If they are moderate to severe illnesses, that is based on any one of these criteria that we had already talked about, they should be tested. If they are test negative, then they are managed according to the existing protocol. But if they are test positive, then one has to consider any of these: oxygen supplementation, antipyretics, antitussives and antibiotics as indicated, metered-dose inhaler if they require a bronchodilator. We prefer a MDI, metered-dose inhaler, over a nebulizer. One may consider other option, that is the hydroxychloroquine may be considered, and we have already discussed in what group we have to consider therapy with hydroxychloroquine. If they fall into any of the high risk category, then it should be given. Now, as far as the antivirals are concerned, it is not across the board, only on a case to case basis within 10 days of symptom onset, as a kind of compassionate ground. In very severe cases, this may be. And if we continue, so among the patients who are mild illness, if they test positive, one can send them on home isolation if possible. And home isolation, if they are more than 72 hours afebrile, or if they are afebrile for 7 days after the symptom onset. So at least for 7 days after symptom onset, they have to be isolated at home. And 2 negative samples have to be checked 24 hours apart. Self-monitoring for fever should be done, give the routine treatment, and explain all the danger signs. If any of them are high-risk individuals, they may be considered for admission based on the clinical judgment wherever required. On the other hand, if any of the mild to severe illness cases worsen with any of these, then they have to be kind of shifted to the ICU, and all the ICU protocol has to be followed, as we have already talked about. But if they improve clinically and radiologically, they are discharged with 2 negative samples being taken 24 hours apart. So this is broadly speaking the kind of algorithm that one may follow for managing patients of COVID who are not critically ill, mild to moderate, but they may go on to become critically ill. So this is the home or the hospital management, non-ICU management of COVID-19. Thank you very much, and thank you for attending this webinar.
We straight away go to the second talk on severe COVID-19 by Dr. Karan Madan. And then at the end of both talks, we've already received a lot of questions, but at the end of both the talks, we'll take the questions to both talks together. So can we have the second talk now?
Good afternoon to all the viewers. This is an ongoing part of the series of webinars on management of COVID that the AIIMS team is undertaking. And in continuation of the previous talks, we are going to discuss the management of severe COVID-19, especially focusing on ARDS and shock in the setting of these patients. So the focus of the talk would be primarily on ARDS. ARDS refers to acute respiratory distress syndrome. It's a common condition which is encountered in critical care settings. In the setting of COVID-19, it is especially important to be aware because ARDS is a common complication and one of the leading causes of mortality. So this is important to know that how do you approach and diagnose a patient with ARDS and what are the basic steps in management of these patients. So when do you suspect ARDS? It's not that difficult. Whenever you see a hypoxemic patient, a patient whose saturations are low, and it comes with a short duration of worsening clinical symptoms. Classically, the patient has a bilateral whiteout opacities on both of the lungs, and there's absence of a cardiac cause to explain the presentation. So essentially, we are looking at a patient who has come with lower oxygen saturations, who is visibly breathless, and whose X-ray shows bilateral whiteout opacities. This is a patient in whom you are suspecting and wanting to diagnose ARDS. So clinically, these patients are usually sick. They come with a history of rapid progression of respiratory distress. They are severely short of breath, sometimes unable to speak and complete sentences. They are tachypneic. There is visible use of accessory muscles of respiration. And sometimes if the hypoxemia is quite severe, they may be visibly cyanosed. The hallmark is presence of severe hypoxemia, which requires a high flow oxygen therapy. And this hypoxia is usually not correctable by oxygen therapy because the physiology underlying these patients is an intrapulmonary shunting, which is happening. That is why they have severe degrees of hypoxemia. We will come on to variables which can help you to detect hypoxemia based on the various definitions of ARDS which have been given. So why is it important to diagnose ARDS? It is very important because ARDS carries with itself a high risk of mortality. In adults, the mortality of ARDS ranges anywhere between 35 to 46%. And there are certain factors which predict an increase in mortality, which include an older age, presence of comorbidities like active cancer, hematological cancer, chronic liver disease, and more severe disease is associated with a higher risk of mortality. And we'll be discussing what is a severe form of ARDS. ARDS per se is less common in children. If it occurs, the mortality is around 18 to 35%. This is very important to know because this is one of the most severe manifestations which the patients with COVID-19 may develop, some proportion of patients, and this may be a leading cause of mortality in them. So how do you identify ARDS? There have been various definitions of ARDS which have been coming and it has evolved. The latest definition which is used is the Berlin definition, which was given in the year 2012 and was published in the Journal of American Medical Association. So what do you need? You need an acute onset of symptoms, which is usually less than 1 week of the known insult or worsening. The lungs have exudate, that is why they look white out. So the origin of edema is usually not explained by a cardiac cause of fluid overload. Then there is oxygen impairment and you grade the severity of oxygen impairment. And you have bilateral opacities on the chest radiographs. And these opacities are not explained by effusions, lung collapse, or nodules on CT or chest X-ray. So how do you remember this? You can remember it easily by a mnemonic called as 4 O's, which means the onset, the origin, which is non-cardiac, the oxygen impairment, and opacities. So once you have these, you suspect ARDS and you diagnose it. It's important to categorize ARDS into varying degrees of severity. So these varying degrees of severity refer to the mild, moderate, and severe ARDS. And what it essentially means is you need to recognize a PaO2 by FiO2 ratio. The PaO2 refers to the partial pressure of oxygen in your arterial blood. And FiO2 is the fraction of inhaled oxygen which the patient is receiving. So whenever a patient has got a PaO2 by FiO2 ratio less than 300, but important to note is that this definition requires a requirement of P. P refers to a positive end expiratory pressure. This means that the PaO2 by FiO2 ratio should be less than 300 with a PEEP of greater than or equal to 5 cm of water. So essentially the Berlin definition has a requirement that the PaO2 by FiO2 criteria should be met when the patient is receiving some sort of low levels of positive end expiratory pressure. So once the PaO2 by FiO2 is less between 200 to 300, that is mild ARDS. Between 100 to 200 is moderate ARDS. And once your PaO2 by FiO2 ratio is less than 100, this is severe ARDS. It is important to recognize the patient with severe ARDS because these patients require a little bit more. they require early recognition, and they require institution of certain modalities early to improve their outcomes, because these are the sickest group of patients and we need to recognize and manage them. So essentially, for categorization of ARDS according to the Berlin definition, you need an arterial blood gas value, and these values can be corrected based on the altitude. If you know, if you are at higher altitude, then a correction factor may be applied. In view of the certain limitations of the Berlin definition of ARDS, a modification of the Berlin definition has been given, which is known as the Kigali modification. And according to this, as you see, because of the limitations of requirement of positive pressure, because you know arterial blood gases and PEEP may not be available at all settings, therefore ARDS was defined without the need of a positive end expiratory pressure. The presence of bilateral opacities can be there in chest radiograph, and an additional factor is lung ultrasound. I'll just show you in a subsequent slide that how can lung ultrasound enable you to detecting fluid in the lung and may aid in the diagnosis of ARDS. And hypoxia, instead of the PaO2 by FiO2 ratio, because PaO2 requires an arterial blood gas. So a saturation or a pulse oximeter is available nearly everywhere at various facilities. So using a SpO2, that is pulse oximetric saturation, is to FiO2 ratio rather than a PaO2 by FiO2 ratio. So once your saturation to FiO2 ratio is less than equal to 315. So this may be useful in resource limited settings, because we don't want that the patient with ARDS should not be recognized and labeled with ARDS if you don't have a PEEP or an arterial blood gas available. This is how lung ultrasound aids in the diagnosis of ARDS. So once you see an ultrasound probe, you know, you place it over the chest wall, and if the lungs are waterlogged, you will see these whitish lines, which are called as B lines. So once you see a diffuse kind of a B profile, this means lines which are starting from the pleura and going all the way down, this would be indicating that in an appropriate clinical setting, there is you know, exudation in the lungs and may aid in the diagnosis of ARDS. So using the presence of B lines and certain other features, you can diagnose ARDS with a good degree of sensitivity and specificity. Therefore, to summarize, how would you recognize ARDS in a setting of suspected COVID? So you would have an acute onset, which will usually be between 1 to 2 weeks, because many patients with COVID worsen during the later first week or second week of their illness. A patient who's hypoxemic with an SpO2 by FiO2 ratio less than 315, or a PaO2 by FiO2 ratio less than 300 while breathing on a PEEP of more than 5 centimeter of water. You have bilateral opacities, which can be diagnosed on a chest X-ray or a CT, or the presence of B lines on lung ultrasound, and you should have an absence of a cardiac or alternative cause to explain the symptoms. And this should be present in the setting of a compatible clinical profile of a subject meeting the criteria for suspected COVID. So this is how you would diagnose ARDS. Essentially, remember, you need an acute onset, you need a hypoxemic patient. You can assess the degree of hypoxemia using the various variables told to you, and they have bilateral white out appearance on their radiographs and absence of a cardiac disease. In children, there's a little difference, because arterial blood gases are less commonly used in children, and saturation is considered as an acceptable alternative to PaO2. So if the ABG is available, a PaO2 by FiO2 ratio less than 300 or a saturation to FiO2 ratio less than 264 may be used. Now coming to the most important point, that now once you've diagnosed a patient with ARDS, how do you go ahead and managing them? Most important is to realize that these patients need an immediate initiation of some sort of an oxygenation or ventilatory support. This may be delivered by three available options, which include a high flow nasal cannula oxygen system, which is of limited availability at many centers, especially in resource limited settings. The second option to use is a non-invasive ventilation, which is ideally delivered through a critical care ventilator. And the third option, which is required maybe in a large majority of patients, is invasive mechanical ventilation after endotracheal intubation. These patients also need supportive treatment, and the patients who have severe ARDS or refractory hypoxemia require certain strategies which may aid in their management. So let us see, how do we initiate the process of oxygen or ventilatory support in these patients? So for, one option is to use a high flow nasal cannula system. So high flow nasal cannula system delivers a high flow of oxygen usually using a nasal cannula, which are given to the patient. This is quite a comfortable system, and delivers quite high flows. But this can be used in selected patients only if the patients are awake, they are cooperative, and are hemodynamically stable. You won't consider this in a patient who's hypotensive and who's having impending respiratory fatigue or arrest. These patients should not have a need for urgent intubation, and they are not in type 2 respiratory failure, thereby meaning their arterial PaCO2 levels are less than 45. It's important to note that even if you give high flow nasal oxygen, 40% or a greater number of patients may still require intubation or mechanical ventilation. And this procedure has a high risk of virus aerosolization because a high flow of oxygen is going. Therefore, in areas where high flow nasal cannula is being given, the personal protective equipment should be donned appropriately. Important to note that if there is no clinical improvement in an hour or so after using high flow nasal cannula, intubation should not be delayed and these patients should be administered invasive mechanical ventilation. The second option, which is more commonly available, is NIV. NIV refers to a non-invasive ventilation. This means that you are not invasively entering the airway by an artificial airway device like an endotracheal tube or a tracheostomy tube. You are usually giving critical care NIV through a full face mask, and you can either give a continuous positive airway pressure, but more commonly what you give is bilevel inspiratory positive airway pressure. Thereby you mean you give them an inspiratory and a positive an expiratory positive airway pressure to aid in their ventilation. As high concentrations for oxygen may be required, which is not possible to deliver through the conventional BiPAP machines which we use in patients with hypoventilation syndromes or sleep apnea, in ARDS, ideally NIV should only be given using a critical care ventilator. Like high flow nasal cannula, it can be tried in selected patients. In case of failure of improvement within 1 to 2 hours, immediate endotracheal intubation and initiation of mechanical ventilation should be considered. And like high flow nasal cannula, NIV also has a high potential for virus aerosolization. Therefore, personal protective equipment should be used appropriately. Non-invasive ventilation can be delivered using multiple interfaces. One of the interfaces which might be a little attractive is the use of a helmet interface. A helmet refers to an interface in which instead of a full face mask, the patient is enclosed in a complete helmet kind of a structure in which the pressure, the bilevel inspiratory positive airway pressure can be given. It might have a possibility of lesser aerosolization. However, there is no consensus on its superiority in patients with COVID-19, but this is one option which may be considered. Non-invasive ventilation and high-flow nasal cannula should be used in ARDS only under close monitoring and only by physicians who are experienced with the management of patients with hypoxic respiratory failure. This is so because patients who are hypoxic, they require very close monitoring. So if you're not monitoring them well and the area is unattended, the patients can have a respiratory arrest or deterioration which might get delayed to recognize. Thereby, if you have facilities and you are intensively monitoring these patients, then NIV and high flow nasal cannula may be tried. Otherwise, it is safer to proceed to endotracheal intubation and mechanical ventilation. NIV and high flow nasal cannula may be used as temporizing measures until invasive mechanical ventilation is initiated, because sometimes if you are having a time, sometimes it's taking to arrange a ventilator and getting the stuff ready. In the meantime, you can use NIV or high flow nasal cannula if available. So is there anything to choose between high flow nasal cannula and NIV? Recent guidelines have come on the management of critically ill COVID patients by the Surviving Sepsis campaign. And they have suggested that high flow nasal cannula may be a little preferable over NIV, though it's a weak recommendation in view of some studies in hypoxic respiratory failure, not COVID-19 per se, showing some benefits of high flow nasal cannula over NIV. But regardless, as we've previously discussed, in patients of COVID-19 who are receiving either non-invasive ventilation or high flow nasal cannula, a close monitoring is recommended for worsening of respiratory status, and early intubation should be considered if any worsening occurs. So coming on to the invasive mechanical ventilation, which is the modality which is going to work, I think, in the large majority of patients with severe COVID-related ARDS. And important to notice that it is not just invasive mechanical ventilation, it is invasive mechanical ventilation with lung protective ventilation. You need to remember this because just putting a patient on a ventilator is not sufficient. You need to know how to handle your ventilator and how to give a lung protective ventilation ARDS, which is very important for the management of these patients. What we mean by an invasive mechanical ventilation is that instead of an interface which is outside the body, you have an interface for giving the ventilation which goes inside the patient's airway, and most commonly it is using an endotracheal tube after endotracheal intubation by which you deliver the invasive mechanical ventilation. The other interfaces may be a nasotracheal tube or laryngeal mask airway, which may be used in a short-term or emergency measure, or a tracheostomy for emergency airway or long-term ventilation. But it is endotracheal intubation which is the most common and preferred route for delivery of invasive mechanical ventilation. This requires sedation, requires appropriate equipment, and also requires trained staff. So let us discuss that, how do you deliver invasive ventilation using a lung protective strategy? So we need to see, what do we mean by lung protective ventilation? So somebody might think, I've just intubated a patient and I'm protecting the patient. So what are you talking about, a lung protective ventilation? We need to know that mechanical ventilation itself is an injurious process, especially in patients with ARDS. Once you intubate them and you give them positive pressures, the positive pressure actually, because the lungs are heterogeneously involved, it distributes in an unequal manner, and it may lead to more opening and more stress in some areas of the lung, and you know, a rapid opening and closing in other areas of the lung. So these are various kinds of trauma which may occur in the setting of invasive mechanical ventilation, which may per se worsen lung injury and initiate systemic inflammation. So by an inappropriate mechanical ventilatory strategy, you can cause something called as a volutrauma or a barotrauma, and you can also cause something called as atelectrotrauma, whereby, you know, if there's a rapid closing and opening of the lung, the airway inflammation gets potentiated. This also spills over into the bloodstream, and this leads to systemic organ dysfunction. So the idea of lung protective ventilation is that you need to minimize alveolar overdistension. You don't need to give so high pressures that your alveoli are overdistended and injured. You also want to minimize a rapid closing and opening of the alveoli, because that will prevent the systemic inflammatory cascade from worsening. Therefore, the ventilatory strategies that we are going to talk about are aimed at the prevention of this very lung injury due to ventilation per se. So this cartoon also depicts that how if you use a non-protective ventilatory strategy, due to the rapid opening and closing of the alveoli, over distension of the alveoli, the initiation of the systemic inflammatory cascade, there's worsening of lung injury, and it does more harm than good to your patient. So this is what lung protective ventilation is. The idea is to keep your lungs a little inflated so that they don't repetitively close and open. That is why, meaning that you give some pressure at the end of expiration to keep the alveoli open. Then you ventilate your alveoli using a low tidal volume over that end expiratory pressure, so that you go to a high tidal volume, which leads to alveolar overdistension. So the idea of lung protective ventilation is that you give some end expiratory pressure, which keeps your alveoli open. On top of that end expiratory pressure, you gently ventilate your lungs using a low tidal volume. So that is the most important component of lung protective ventilation. So how do you initiate? The patient is visibly sick, so initially you have to intubate the patient. Especially in the setting of COVID-19, aerosol precautions need to be taken. And there is a concept of some hospitals having an intubation teams which are dedicated with personal protective equipment, who are designated with the job of doing the endotracheal intubation of these patients. Important is that if you have a patient who's sick in front of you, who's hypoxic, you should just not immediately rush to just trying to put an endotracheal tube without pre-oxygenating the patient. So pre-oxygenation is very, very important. You should pre-oxygenate them with 100% oxygen for at least 3 to 5 minutes. And the pre-oxygenation options include using either a bag and face mask, using an NIV using a full face mask, or using a high flow nasal cannula. The idea is that you get some window to intubate the patients in time, so that you are not rushing and the patient does not have a hypoxic respiratory arrest. So once you've intubated the patient, the usual and the most commonly described mode which is used in these patients on the ventilator is volume control mode, and you usually deliver it using the assist control mode of mechanical ventilation. So let us see, how do you handle the ventilatory mode? So the assist control mode is the mode which is usually used. So there are 4 cardinal parameters which you need to set on the ventilator. These 4 include setting a tidal volume, giving an end expiratory pressure as we talked about, which is called as PEEP, adjusting what concentration of oxygen you want to give, that is FiO2, and the respiratory rate you want to set. There are certain other parameters also, out of which the important ones are the inspiratory-expiratory ratio and the flow which can be given. So there's a golden rule which you may remember, because these, if you remember these 3 points, the management of ARDS for you would become very easy. You would need to know which variable you need to tamper with to adjust what parameter. So always remember that ventilation, that means what ventilation patient is receiving, is determined by the tidal volume and respiratory rate. In fact, the tidal volume multiplied by the respiratory rate is your ventilation. So if you reduce the tidal volume, you reduce the respiratory rate, that will lead to reduction in ventilation. The other thing is what determines your airway pressure. So obviously PEEP is a pressure. So an elevation in PEEP would lead to increase in airway pressures. And the second most important variable is tidal volume, because the pressures in a cavity is inversely proportional to the volume which you give. So if you give high tidal volumes, it will lead to increase in your airway pressures. So tidal volume and PEEP determine the airway pressures. What determines your oxygenation? So oxygenation is determined by the concentration of oxygen which you are giving. That is quite logical. And second thing is end expiratory pressure. The higher the end expiratory pressure you give, that leads to greater opening of the alveoli and greater diffusion of oxygen. So if you remember these 3 points, the management of ARDS would become quite easy for you. So there are certain targets for us once we are considering lung protective ventilation. So these targets include, first of all, using a low tidal volume strategy. So what do we mean by a low tidal volume? That is 6 milliliters per kilogram of ideal body weight. The second target is that by giving a low tidal volume, you eventually want to control the airway pressures. You don't want the pressures in the airway to rise, which cause more damage. So the objective parameter to be noted is the plateau airway pressure, which should be always maintained less than and equal to less than 30 centimeters of water wherever possible. The target saturation, usually in the setting of ARDS, is recommended to be 88% to 93%. You don't want to be ventilating your patients at 100% saturation, because by trying to achieve that, you'll be employing some ventilative strategies which has possibility of causing lung injury. There's some data to suggest that in patients with COVID-19 related ARDS, you may want to have a slightly higher oxygen threshold, but mostly in patients of ARDS, what we want to maintain is something like 88% to 93%. So various predicted body weight calculator equations are available. This is one of the equations in which for men and women, you can use this equation using their height. So the only thing you need to calculate the predicted body weight is just measuring the height of the patient. And once you measure that, you can put it into the formula and that will give you the predicted body weight. And then you set your tidal volume as 6 milliliters per kilogram of the predicted body weight. So you want to have a plateau pressure target of less than 30 centimeters of water. So how do you see the plateau pressure? The plateau pressure is measured because whenever you are ventilating a patient, you have some waveforms in front of you. So a pressure time waveform or a pressure time scalar is something which you need to look at. And if you see the airway pressure curves, initially the airway pressure rises, it reaches a peak airway pressure. And then if you give an inspiratory pause for around say 0.5 seconds, the airway pressure dips and stabilizes for a while. So this dip and where the airway pressure stabilizes is called the plateau pressure. So this plateau pressure is basically the parameter which suggests where your lung compliance is. If your plateau pressure is increasing, this means your lungs are more stiff and less compliant. And you need to measure the plateau pressure and try to monitor it, because a higher plateau pressure would lead to lung injury. So how do you put the initial settings? So initially you can set your tidal volume approximately 6 to 8 ml per kg of predicted body weight. You set a respiratory rate to approximate the minute ventilation. If the patient is not paralyzed or deeply sedated, if you suggest set a respiratory rate anywhere around 12 to 20, the patient is spontaneously triggering the breathing and maintaining the minute ventilation. You set an inspiratory flow rate, usually around 50 to 60 liter per minute. And initially you can set the FiO2 to 100% because the patient may be hypoxic, and then you want to bring the oxygen saturations. Initially you can set a PEEP level anywhere around 5 to 10 centimeter of water or higher, and then adjust accordingly. We'll come to that, how you adjust the PEEP and FiO2 and other variables. As soon as you initiate the patient on mechanical ventilation, you need to institute monitoring. The monitoring would include pulse oximetric saturation, ventilatory parameters, and the ventilator waveforms continuously, because you want to keep a close watch on the airway pressures and the patient's hemodynamics to look for any worsening. Arterial blood gases should be obtained periodically as needed, because you want to have a look at the pH, the oxygenation, and PCO2, because you want to change your decisions according to that. So what's your target? Your initial target, as we discussed, was to maintain a plateau pressure less than 30. So if, in case even at 6 ml per kg of tidal volume, your plateau pressure is more than 30, so then there's an option of reducing the tidal volume further by 1 ml per kg gradually. You can come down to up to 4 ml per kg, but that would mean sometimes a very low tidal volume which is being given to the patient, which might, you know, translate into reduced minute ventilation, as we saw in the previous slides. Tidal volume goes down, the ventilation goes down. Now, if the ventilation goes down, you want to compensate that by increasing, obviously, the respiratory rate to maintain the minute ventilation, because the minute ventilation is a product of tidal volume and respiratory rate. So you increase your respiratory rate to maintain the minute ventilation. And as you saw, that once your tidal volumes are reduced, once the ventilation comes down, there is sometimes the PCO2 or the carbon dioxide in the blood may rise, which is called as permissive hypercapnia. You allow that to happen, we'll be discussing that. And you don't need to be worrying about arterial CO2 levels rising in the setting of ARDS too much. We'll be discussing that. And these patients may have asynchrony at low tidal volume, so you should monitor them and treat that appropriately. So as we had discussed, minute ventilation is the product of tidal volume and respiratory rate. So you can compensate one variable, that if you reduce the tidal volume, you compensate that by increasing the respiratory rate. That would lead to increased CO2, but that is acceptable in this setting. So reduction of, so increase in PCO2, which happens due to our low tidal volume strategy or lung protective strategy, is called as permissive hypercapnia. This means elevation of PCO2 will be normal when you are ventilating a patient with a lung protective strategy in the setting of ARDS. You need to be aware of that, because you don't want to be chasing to correcting your PCO2 all the time, because by doing that, you'll be doing more harm. So there is mortality benefit of lung protective ventilation, and there is no benefit to normalizing PCO2 and pH in this setting. So if your pH is between 7.15 to 7.3, any pH above 7.3, you are fine. When it is between 7.15 to 7.3, you increase your respiratory rate till your pH is more than 7.3 or the PCO2 is less than 35, by maximally increasing the respiratory rate up to 35. And you can use some other measures to reduce the dead space, that is like reducing the IE ratio. You can shorten the tube down or remove the connectors in the circuit so that the acidosis can improve. Only once your pH is severely low, that is, you know, at levels less than 7.15, you may consider certain measures for that. In that setting, you might have to increase your tidal volume to increase the pH. You might have to give sodium bicarbonate intravenously. And if necessary, in these settings, sometimes the plateau pressure target may be temporarily exceeded. In certain patients, you need to know that the plateau pressure of 30 target may not be met. Say the patient is severely obese, patient is pregnant and has some sort of chest wall restrictive abnormality. In these patients, because of an extra thoracic cause, there is some pressure being kept on the diaphragm and eventually on the thoracic cavity. So in these patients, if you recognize them, you may, on a case-to-case basis, ventilate them with a plateau pressure target which is more than 30, but that has to be under close monitoring, and you need to know what you are doing and having a close watch on these patients. So how do you oxygenate them? So the oxygenation goals using in ARDS are usually by an PEEP FiO2 table, which is given by the ARDS net strategy. So you titrate your FiO2. This means you want to give them the least possible concentration of oxygen as possible to maintain their saturation to 88 to 93, because oxygen concentrations above 60% may themselves be associated with the risk of oxygen toxicity. So that is why you want to increase the end expiratory pressure so that you can get your FiO2 down to a reasonable value. So you can use these PEEP FiO2 tables which have been given. So there's a low PEEP FiO2 strategy and a high PEEP low FiO2 strategy. Usually you should remember that for moderate to severe ARDS patient, especially in the setting of COVID-19, a higher PEEP strategy may be employed. This would mean that if you are giving, you know, a patient with a particular fractional inhaled concentration of oxygen, you first increase your PEEP before you increase the FiO2. This would be the main aim of this strategy. So according to the Sarvagam Sepsis campaign guidelines, they have suggested that a higher PEEP strategy over a lower PEEP strategy may be used in patients with COVID-19 in moderate to severe ARDS, though it's a weak recommendation. It's very important to note that once you are using a high PEEP strategy, you need to monitor your patients for barotrauma, because these patients may have pneumothorax, pneumomediastinum. These are the sort of problems which can happen once the high PEEP is being given. So these patients need close monitoring. Other important supportive management in these patients with ARDS is that you need to use a restrictive fluid strategy. You don't want to be overloading your patients with a lot of fluid, giving them positive balance, because that is likely to do them more harm than good. It's likely to lead to increase in lung exudation and worsening of hypoxemia. It's safe to use in patients with ARDS that are not in shock or don't have an acute kidney injury, and at least 12 hours after vasopressor use. And a restrictive fluid strategy leads to fewer days of invasive mechanical ventilation. You need to monitor the urine output and CVP closely and minimize the boluses of fluid and avoid a positive balance. So it has been suggested that a conservative fluid strategy may be used in patients with COVID-19 related ARDS as compared to a liberal fluid strategy. Now let us come to severe ARDS. Severe ARDS is a phenotype of patients who are quite sick. They are the sickest of patients. You have recognized them by seeing a PaO2 by FiO2 ratio, which is less than 100. These patients may be difficult to manage by the lung protective strategy alone, as we have discussed previously. Using a lung protective ventilation strategy also, they may develop severe refractory hypoxemia, severe acidosis, and you might not be able to achieve lung protective ventilation targets. So it's important to recognize them early, because there are certain interventions which you can institute early, and you can minimize the harmful effects of ventilatory strategy. So let us see how do we approach the patient with severe ARDS. So this is an algorithm which has been given by a training module of WHO, that in most patients and in all patients with ARDS, especially in mild to moderate patients, you can do with a lung protective ventilation and fluid restrictive strategy. But in patients with severe ARDS, in addition to lung protective ventilation and fluid restriction, you can additionally use some modalities, out of which the one of the most effective and the commonly used modalities, which is relatively safer also, is a prone position ventilation. And if patients have a lot of ventilator asynchrony, using neuromuscular blockade agents for around 48 hours. If the lung protective ventilation targets are not met, there are certain other options which are available for severe ARDS patients, which include a higher PEEP strategy, giving them recruitment maneuvers, or considering them for ECMO. ECMO is something called as an extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. We'll discuss that. So this is what we mean by a prone position ventilation. By conventional teaching, patients on mechanical ventilator are lying supine with their, you know, their backs down on the bed. But in a prone ventilation, you turn the patient on their abdomen. So there's some rationale, because studies have shown that proning these patients can lead to improvement in the ventilation. This shows you a cartoon which shows you how the prone position ventilation works. So in a patient with ARDS, if you focus on the figure A, it shows that the lower zones and the lower lobes are quite atelectated and consolidated. So once you've proned the patient, say in this figure B, this shows how the bases and the lower lobes have started to get aerate. So even once you turn the patient prone, you ventilate them, and then after you make them supine and do proning again, the ventilation of the bases improves, the compressive effect of the heart on the lungs reduces, so it has some benefits in the oxygenation parameters. So these are various strategies. High PEEP strategy, recruitment maneuvers may be tried in select group of patients, but giving recruitment maneuvers have their own risk. They have a risk of causing hypotension, barotrauma, and if the patient has a lot of ventilator asynchrony, neuromuscular blockade is something which can be used for a transient period of time, usually up to 48 hours. So if you see some recommendations which are there, they have, like the WHO, they have suggested that in moderate to severe ARDS, a prone ventilation is suggested up to 12 to 16 hours in patients with moderate to severe ARDS over no prone ventilation. In patients who have a persistent ventilator dyssynchrony, those who are requiring a lot of sedation to keep them comfortable, who are being prone, and patients who have persistently high plateau pressures, a continuous neuromuscular blockade infusion like cisalteratrium may be used up to 48 hours. And in if at all somebody is using recruitment maneuvers, they are usually not recommended as in the patient with severe ARDS because they can have harm rather than good. You don't use the staircase or incremental PEEP recruitment maneuvers because they can be associated with more harm. In certain group of patients who fail to improve with your conventional strategies by lung protective ventilation, by proning them, there can be a consideration for a referral or initiation of these patients where a veno-venous ECMO can be initiated. ECMO is actually, you can say, one of the last lines, last resorts in a patient with hypoxemic respiratory failure, which may be dried, in which essentially the function of oxygenation is taken away from the lungs. The blood is taken out. It goes into a machine outside, which is an artificial membrane oxygenator. The blood is oxygenated, then returned back to the body. So ECMO machine means essentially taking the blood from the body, oxygenating it outside your body, and then returning it back. There is no data which suggests that initial upfront ECMO is any way better than a strategy in which you give conservative strategies followed by selective patients getting ECMO. So this is a modality which can be considered on case-to-case basis in settings where it may be available. So this cartoon essentially summarizes that once you approach a patient with ARDS, you initially start with a lung protective ventilation strategy. And if your patients are fitting into the criteria of severe ARDS, you take a stepwise approach, consider for approaches like prone positioning, neuromuscular blockade, and ECMO in a stepwise manner as your patient progresses. There are certain other precautions which you need to take. You need to avoid disconnecting the patient from the ventilator to prevent lung collapse, because as soon as you disconnect them, there can be possible to have rapid alveolar de-recruitment and patient will desaturate. So one approach for that, especially useful in COVID-19 settings, would be use a closed suctioning system, because you don't want to open the ventilator circuit for suctioning, because that would lead to rapid aerosolization and risk to your staff. So you should use a closed suctioning system, and suction only should be performed when it's absolutely essential and not routinely. You may clamp the endotracheal tube when disconnection is required transiently and minimize the unnecessary transport of these patients. These patients require a good degree of pain management and sedation, because you cannot ventilate patients with severe and moderate ARDS without giving them adequate comfort. So essential is to implement a protocolized management to pain, agitation, and delirium, and using standardized scales for assessment of pain and agitation, like a visual analog scale, or there are certain scales which are available, like a Ramsey sedation scale, Richmond agitation sedation scale. So thereby it means that you objectively assess the patient's level of pain and agitation, and you appropriately manage them. What you need to remember from this slide is that first of all, you should treat pain. Pain treatment is most important. You treat it using opioids or non-opioid agent, so that you minimize the harmful effects of sedation. You should not blindly be administering sedative agents like midazolam to these patients while the patient may actually be in pain. So a pain-centered, management-centered strategy should be used. Even after giving adequate pain relief, if the anxiety is there, you can use benzodiazepines. And also important is to note for the presence and treatment of delirium in the ICU. So these are certain guidelines which was based on a review of literature which were put forward by the Surviving Sepsis Campaign, which were published in Intensive Care Medicine. As the data on COVID-19 specific therapies is quite limited as of date, most of this data has been extrapolated from guidelines of general sepsis, septic shock management, and ARDS management per se. From these, certain important points which can be taken and which can be useful in the management of our patients may be there, so we can discuss a few of them. Regarding the hemodynamic support, many patients with COVID-19 have shock and cardiac injury. In fact, data shows that a shock may be present in 1 to 35% of the patients, and evidence of myocardial injury by the evidence of increased cardiac enzymes in the blood may be present in 7 to 23% of your patients. So the recommendation is that in patients with COVID-19 and shock, dynamic parameters for fluid responsiveness should be used, which are like skin temperature, capillary filling time, and serum lactate measurement over static parameters to assess fluid responsiveness. This is also an extrapolation from non-COVID septic shock settings. And in patients who have COVID-19, have shock and ARDS, a conservative over a liberal fluid strategy may be considered. And you should consider crystalloids over colloids for resuscitating these patients. And if crystalloids are being used, there may be some suggestion of using a buffered or a balanced crystalloid rather than unbalanced crystalloids like normal saline for resuscitation. And these are also extrapolations from the available guidelines per se, not specific to COVID-19. For vasopressors, a norepinephrine may be used as the first-line vasoactive agent. If not available, either vasopressin or epinephrine may be used. But it's important to note that dopamine should not be used as the preferred first-line vasopressor agent. If norepinephrine is available, there's a recommendation against using dopamine. For corticosteroids, this is an area which gathers a lot of interest. So in patients with COVID-19 and refractory shock, a low-dose corticosteroid therapy may be administered. And by low-dose, what this meant is a typical dose of, say, 50 milligram four times a day or a 200 milligram per day of hydrocortisone equivalent may be administered. In patients with COVID-19 who do not have ARDS, routine administration of steroids should not be undertaken. But in patients who are mechanically ventilated with COVID-19 and who have ARDS, the Surviving Sepsis Campaign systematic review and expert opinion has suggested that systemic corticosteroids may be administered over not using corticosteroids in these patients, but this is a weak recommendation. Clinicians can do that on a case-to-case basis, but not routinely. And if at all you are using corticosteroids in the setting of ARDS in COVID-19, you should use a lower dosing and a shorter treatment course. Some studies in COVID-19 which have reported use of corticosteroids have reported doses up to 1 to 2 milligram per kilogram of methylprednisolone per day over 5 to 7 days. So that is something which may be considered on a case-to-case basis. So we see that patients with COVID-19 are prone to a major complication which has a risk of mortality, which includes ARDS per se. So in most patients with ARDS, invasive mechanical ventilation with lung protective ventilation will be a preferred treatment. In certain patients, high flow nasal cannula or NIV, you can use as a temporizing measure till initiation of invasive mechanical ventilation, or you can use them in patients with mild ARDS, but always remember that it should be done under very close monitoring. Clinical evidence shows that implementation of lung protective ventilation saves lives as compared to usual care. So always remember that just putting the patient on a ventilator does not mean that your job is over. Your job just starts then. You need to see how you tailor your ventilatory strategy so that you prevent further injury to these patients. And prone ventilation and ECMO are options for patients with severe and refractory ARDS. Thank you very much. And thank you very much for a patient hearing. And we'll be happy to, you know, get some questions from you and like to answer them. In case you have any questions which are not being able to be answered at this point of time, you may send an email to us, and then we may revert back to you appropriately. Thank you very much.
So, thank you very much for logging into us, and on behalf of my colleague Dr. Karan and myself, we really appreciate your presence over the last 1 hour, and we hope that you were able to imbibe some good tips and pointers of this disease and the management. Over the course of these webinars, we got a large number of questions continuously, and we'll try to take up some of them now over the next few minutes, and we'll try to kind of solve whatever issues you had. So if you want to begin off with that, a large number of questions were related to the HCQS and the HCQS treatment and prophylaxis. So one question was that is HCQS effective? Well, basically, to be honest, we do not have very good evidence related to the efficacy of HCQS. Whatever information we have is related to in vitro studies and also in some uncontrolled trials, and both of these have shown faster clearance of the virus when HCQS was given. So even the trials on humans were uncontrolled by a French group, and they demonstrated a faster clearance of the virus when this was given compared to those in whom this drug was not given. So that is what we have, and based on that only the recommendations, whatever is available, has been made. Okay, Karan, I think you want to take the next one.
Regarding the management, we had a question on role of high flow nasal cannula in non-invasive ventilation. High flow nasal cannula systems are not available at many places, though some ventilators have a high flow oxygen mode by which you can administer it. Non-invasive ventilation is available at many places, but it's important to note that you use a conventional ventilator to give non-invasive ventilation. The problem with both the modalities is, one is that they have a high potential for aerosolization, so adequate personal protective equipment is very important. And it's also been advised by some settings that if giving non-invasive ventilation and high flow nasal cannula, it should be done possibly in a negative pressure room design. The second thing is that many of the patients may be quite hypoxic, and based on the Chinese experience also, if the patient is not improving within 1 hour, and the parameter of improvement is most importantly is respiratory rate and patient comfort. So if you feel your respiratory rate is not coming less than 30 after an hour or so of NIV use, and the patient is having worsening respiratory distress, you should intubate those patients. So I think the safe option is that if you are not familiar with these modalities, and if your patient is sick, you directly proceed to endotracheal intubation and mechanical ventilation.
Okay, so again, a couple of questions again related to HCQS. I'll try to take them all together now. So a question was about the indications of HCQS as a prophylaxis and treatment. This was already actually covered in this presentation, but just to summarize, as a treatment, HCQS is recommended for moderate or severe cases, and in some mild cases where there are risk factors. So the risk factors, the list of risk factors was also enumerated. So in these, it may have a role. As far as prophylaxis is concerned, that also was mentioned. As of now, the ICMR recommends prophylaxis with HCQS for healthcare workers who are actively managing confirmed or suspected patients with COVID infection, and for household contacts of confirmed patients with COVID infection. So apart from this, they have not recommended HCQS prophylaxis for any other group. That is probably the single most important message that we would like to give, because there is a huge, interest, or there is a kind of a feeling that every healthcare worker should be taking HCQS. So as of now, that is not the case. So that is the one message you want to give. Question, what to do if allergic? One is allergic to HCQS. So, well, if already you know that, then obviously you will not take. If you know you have got allergic tendency to maybe other drugs, one will have to be very, very cautious and maybe just weigh the risk benefits, you know, whether you really need to take it or not. And if so, then maybe take adequate precautions. Question was, what about quinolones and macrolides along with HCQS for QT prolongation? So basically, one should not take drugs which can cause QT prolongation along with HCQS. That includes quinolones and macrolides. So probably it is not to be taken. Better not to take HCQS if you are already taking something else which can add on to this toxicity. And one last question on HCQS was on side effects. So side effects are basically same. QT prolongation, then there are certain cases of bone marrow suppression, hepatotoxicity has been described, and when it is taken for a chronic long period of time, then there are chances of getting retinopathy. So these are some questions related to HCQS that probably we thought we'll clarify to you. Okay.
There was one more question related to hydroxychloroquine, that should we routinely check for G6PD deficiency? So if you see that there is no good quality data available on HCQS role in safety in G6PD deficiency, there are some reports of retrospective data of patients who were receiving G6PD hydroxychloroquine and G6PD. Though no major issues were found, but it's important to note that there are certain variants of G6PD in which the severe deficiency is there, and there's a possibility of side effects. So I think if there's any history of a G6PD deficiency or any history of severe hemolytic reaction in the past, I think those patients should avoid taking hydroxychloroquine in all circumstances, because the efficacy also is quite uncertain. And we have one more question, which is about the effect of fluid strategy on oxygenation. So the data on fluid strategy is basically from studies on ARDS per se, in which it has been seen that if you use a fluid conservative strategy rather than a liberal strategy, the patient's outcomes are improved, and it also helps in early liberation from mechanical ventilation. So you should avoid fluid boluses, and you should have a conservative fluid strategy, slowly giving fluids, monitoring the hemodynamics and monitoring the urine output. So that's important from that perspective.
Well, some other questions related to some general precautions. Should other specialty doctors attending emergency in unknown COVID status use PPE? Well, what we can say is that standard protection methods should be adopted. So whatever standard protection method means protection by the droplet infection and physical barrier, so the hand hygiene. So these are the two things which probably everybody as of now in this particular situation one should adopt. Beyond that, I think it would be a little difficult to recommend for every specialty attending unknown patients what to do, but standard precautions, yes, definitely one has to take. Will home isolation spread to other members of the household? Well, technically, of course, it can. So that is why, again, we dwelt on quite a bit of detail of what you have to do with the do's and don'ts when you are at home. So all, again, those barrier protections, the cuff etiquettes, the hand hygienes, the physical isolation in one separate room, using different clothes, a separate washroom, so maintaining a particular distance from the other. So all these things come into play, and if that is done, then the chances of getting cross infection from one to the other, even at home, become very, very minimal. Instructions to OPD doctor not dealing with non-fever cases, again the same thing. See, basic level of protection, personal protection is recommended and should be used by all healthcare workers irrespective of which specialty they are, and that is one thing that we have to look at.
So I think that's about it.
I think there are one or two more than
one more question.
Yeah, I think there was some question related to whether smokers are at high risk. Well, again, smoking status, higher smoking status does make one more vulnerable to COVID-19 infection, that is true. And the reason for that probably is because of the frequent contact of the fingers during the act of smoking with the mouth, and thereby increasing the chances of cross-contamination of the particles or the infection. That may be one reason. There was a question regarding the sensitivity of the RT-PCR method. Well, although that is considered to be the gold standard, but in a study in which they compared this with the CT scan findings, they found a sensitivity anywhere ranging between 50 to 80%. But again, microbiological confirmation is this, the RT-PCR is the gold standard as of now, the most definitive test for COVID. And there was a question asking whether there is any relationship between BCG vaccination and COVID mortality. Again, these are all ecological kind of studies which have models which have made, in which there may be an inverse correlation, and we have also looked at that. There seems to be an inverse correlation between the prevalence or the incidence of tuberculosis versus the incidence of COVID as of now. Probably there is a trend that COVID is less common in the tropics where TB is high, and vice versa. So that is just some very, very preliminary type of data. There is no RCT on this. There is an ongoing trial in Australia which may give something regarding the effect of BCG on the COVID infections. So I think there is one more who would like to talk about this one. I think role of convalescent serum. This was a
Role of in evolving modalities. One is role of convalescent plasma. So there's a small patient series of 5 patients in which the convalescent plasma was used. And these patients were on mechanical ventilation. So out of 5 patients, 3 patients were extubated, though the duration of their mechanical ventilation was quite long. So based on this, there has been approval, I think, by the US FDA for a trial basis of this modality. So I think there are certain modalities which are evolving, and we would have to give some modalities based on a case-to-case basis, based on the available evidence. So I think with time, we will have more answers to these questions. If the spread of the epidemic can be slowed down in our setting with the various modalities, I think it might buy us time so that more such modalities may become approved. So I think that is all for the webinar series for today. We'll also have a webinar by the nursing, a webinar which will be live streamed after some time.
If possible, yeah. So again, on behalf of my team, my colleague Karan, I thank you all for being with us. Thank you for all the participation, all the questions, and we hope that we have been able to kind of disseminate some useful information to you. Thank you.
And I'll also like to thank the whole team along with us, my colleague Dr. Saurabh, our DM fellows, Dr. Tejas, Dr. Shrayama, Dr. Pavan Tiwari, our colleague, for contributing to jotting down these questions together and answering these questions. and helping out with the
and helping to find the answers also.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.